Your answer too.
It's called, so I joined with Pierre and Nico. It's called Diverging Trends in National and Local Concentration. And it's a paper that concerns your choice of restaurant yesterday night. So yesterday night you came to Richmond, you were looking for a restaurant, and you were considering where to go. Some of you, you know, don't care that much, may go to whatever you find. Some others may be more special in terms of what you would like to eat. And then you went to, you know, a more upscale restaurant. But whatever your choice was, what I'm pretty sure you didn't do is go to Washington or New York or LA to eat your meal. Now that seems like an obvious thing to say. Almost you're gonna say, well, are we in this conference to hear about this? Obviously, I didn't go there. But the point is very simple. The point is that this is a market, the restaurant business, that is local. That when you decide where to go for for a meal, you don't consider things that are very far away. You consider things that are close to you. Okay. Now, when you think about the literature on concentration and the kind of consistent narrative that has emerged from the literature on concentration, this literature seems to have forgotten about this basic fact that a lot of these markets are local. And so, you know, there's this large literature that by now, and I mean we agree with this, has documented increases in national product market concentration. But this fact, this basic fact, has also served as a cornerstone fact for a consistent narrative, and many of you have, you know, contributed to this narrative, which is, well, it's not only concentration, it's markups, it's profits, it's dynamism, it's declining labor share, etc. Now, this basic fact on concentration, national concentration, is what we're going to come and we're going to try to challenge. And the basic challenge is not the fact that, is not to the fact, we're going to agree with that national concentration has increased, or our data is going to be consistent with the fact that national concentration has increased. But we're going to argue that when we look at smaller definitions or narrower geographic definitions of these markets, then you find something completely different. And the dynamics and concentration that you find are exactly the opposite in most markets. And so that's what we're going to do. And to do that, we're going to use the NETS data, so the National Establishment Time Series, and we're going to do it from 1990 to 2014. That's the data that that we have. So this is a very simple paper. It's really a facts paper. I'm going to show you four basic facts. The first fact is that overall and for all major sectors in the U.S. economy, concentration is increasing at the national level, but it's actually decreasing at the local level. So if I group these sectors in, say, one-digit sectors, that's true for all sectors. You see these diverging trends in all sectors. The second fact that I'm going to show you is that if we go much more narrow in terms of the sectoral definition, and we go like to an eight-digit SIC classification, and we start counting, you know, what are the sectors where you see increasing trends, what are the sectors where you see decreasing trends in national and in local concentration, the sectors where you see diverging trends, increasing national, decreasing local, are pervasive. They are everywhere. Right? They're in manufacturing and they are in services. Now, there are more in services than in manufacturing. I'll show you that too, but they're pretty much everywhere. And the third fact, then we're going to try to ask, well, what's going on? How can this be? And for that, we're going to try to explore a little bit with our data the role of top firms. And what I'm going to try to show you is that the top firm in an industry, if I focus on industries where I see diverging trends, is contributing to both the increase in national concentration and the decrease in local concentration. So the top firms are doing both things, right? So, So what's going on, or what is the basic idea that what I want you to have in your hands is, well, Walmart is expanding. The way Walmart is expanding is by adding more establishments in more parts of the U.S. And by doing that, it's obviously increasing its national concentration or the share in the market where Walmart operates at the national level. But it's all. But if Walmart is now competing with a local monopoly in each location, then Walmart is also decreasing local concentration, right? So if there was one monopoly everywhere, and now Walmart comes and takes 90% of the market in every location, you see exactly diverging trends, right? And so that's going to be our facts are consistent with that. And then the final thing is we're going to do a case studies, and I'm going to show you what happens in the average market when a top firm enters. So when a top firm opens an establishment in one of these markets, what happens to other establishments, in particular, what happens to these measures of concentration or the Herfindahl index of concentration? Okay. So that's the plan. The paper is essentially just about showing you those four facts. Yep.
So both of your examples with both restaurants and Walmart are sort of about kind of final retailers or final consumption. Like conceptually, how are you going to think about, local a lot of the facts are about like production for like tradable goods, like the market may or may not be local depending on particular sector.
I'm not going to take a particular stand. I'm just going to do it for the different sectors, and I'm going to show you the results for the different sectors. But I think you're exactly right that this notion of local markets is very important for some things. It is irrelevant for others.
And then the related question is, how do you think about like online spending in this context? Like, would you want to include that as a local competitor or a national thing?
I mean, we don't address online sales directly, but we've looked at some of these online, firms like Amazon. And the way I would think about it is, we've been thinking about it is, well, Amazon, has a bunch of establishments to sell their products from those establishments. We have some information about the sales of those establishments, and so we're thinking about, concentration of those establishments relative to other establishments.
Yeah.
So all establishments. I mean, it's not only distribution. It's any establishment that Amazon has that is in a particular industry. I can look at it and see what has happened to that industry. Okay, now we're going to use these National Establishment Time Series data, which is data provided by Walls and Associates from Dun and Bradstreet. And this is, I guess, not your standard data source.
In the sense that most of the studies of
firm-level concentration have been done either for large firms like Jan was doing in CompuStat, or better with census data. Now, NETS has a couple of advantages for us relative to census. First thing is that it's easy to get here at the bank, but also it allows us to look at the effect of the individual first, which the census wouldn't allow us to release. So that's one thing. And the other is it gives us sales for the whole economy. Now, there's a question of how accurate these measurements or this data is relative to the census, and there have been a number of studies that have tried to assess that. When we started with this project, we kind of didn't really know that NETS had all sorts of potential challenges out there. Since then, we've done a lot of work to try to see the extent to which we think it's good data and is data that is informative for the question at hand. We think it is. I'll show you some things in a second. So it's data on sales, employment, the owning enterprise, primary industry, and for all establishments. And in particular, it has the industry at the 8-digit level. And very detailed geographic location of the establishment. We're going to take out a bunch of sectors that some of the analysis out there says are particularly problematic in NETs, so agriculture, education, government, mining, and nonprofits. So none of that, these sectors are never in anything that I'm going to show you. Now, so what are the potential concerns? So one is that, you know, there's discrepancies relative to the county and business patterns. So
what we've done is we've tried to correlate the employment counts in NETs
with employment counts with the public publicly available data in CBP at the zip code level. So for that, for example, we have total employment. And so we can correlate total employment in NETs and the CBP, and we find consistently very high correlations that, you know,
don't vary that much over time. And so so we think that's pretty good. Those are not by industry,
so that's potentially a concern. But for overall employment, we think it works well. We're also gonna a lot of the problems that some papers have highlighted come because NETS has a lot of small enterprise, some small establishments, more small establishment than CBP. So
we're going to do a lot of robustness in terms of excluding the very small firms, etc.
And none of that is going to be very important for anything that we're going to say. Okay. Mm.
So in the paper we do a lot more robustness in terms of comparing this data every time with only the public part of the CBP. Okay. So I'm going to show you facts related to concentration, and so all of it is going to be based on some index of concentration at the industry level, at the industry level at a particular location in a particular point in time. So we're going to use Herfindahl. So this is, you know, that's the standard formula of the Herfindahl, of course. And we're going to use it for two. I'm going to show you facts for four different aggregations: the country, geographic aggregations, the country as a whole, cities, counties, and zip codes. At some point, I'm gonna show you that doesn't. The degree matters a little bit, but it's not that relevant in terms of the main patterns. And so, at some point, I'm just gonna show you some things for zip codes, just not to, you know, keep showing you the same thing. And one, and the other thing is this everything that I'm gonna tell you is robust to all sorts of different measures of concentration. So this is not particular to the Herfindahl index, right? Now, one thing that you have to be a little bit careful about is measures of concentration that are, say, the share of the top four firms or the share of the top so many firms. If that so many firms is a large number, so where large means it's like four or five, when you go to these very narrow markets, there's a lot of zeros, right? So you are selecting the sample quite a bit when you do that, and so those tend to be problematic in general. And so some people have said, well, if I use this, you know, I find different things. Yeah, but that's just because of the selection that you're selecting out a lot of the zip codes, say. That we do include in our calculation. So that's, you're just basing it out of very few zip codes. Selection is not driving our results. We know that for sure because we've done a consistent panel. So eliminating any sort of selection issue in these results. Okay. Now what I'm going to show you is changes, or essentially the evolution of this Herfindahl index over time.
And so for that, in order to avoid issues with comparing different industries, what I'm going to do is essentially going to show you the changes, and I'm going to aggregate the changes. The way I'm going to aggregate, we can do that in different ways, but we're going to aggregate in general with employment shares. Okay, so
everything that I'm going to tell you, whenever I'm aggregating, and I'm aggregating with employment shares, the changes themselves. Right, I'm not aggregating levels, I'm aggregating change, right? So this is, I guess, the main
fact here.
So this is the change, so it's all normalized in
1990. So So this is the average change in the Herfindahl index between 1990 and 2014.
You see the blue line is the national index, so you see the increase.
That's what other people have, you know, shown before.
And then you see the local measures. So this is, again, city, county, and zip code.
It's more extreme, the more narrow. But, I mean, you see a big decline in the levels of concentration.
Yeah.
One thing that I would be worried of is, like, if you think about these places, some of these zip codes have been growing in population, have been developed.
Yeah.
As they're developed, you get more farms coming in. And so somehow you would want to control for population, the changes in population in these.
Right. So this particular measure that we're using, the Herfindahl index as is, depends on the total number of firms, right? On the level of firms. So because of that, it could, you know, that could definitely influence our results. But you can use measures that don't depend on the total number of firms, right? They depend only on the distribution of firms, and you find similar things. So just the scale, right? Whether you have 10 firms vis-a-vis 20 firms, condition on the distribution and the shape of the distribution, you can use measures that would give you the same level of concentration, and you find exactly the same results. So that we've done.
Stick.
Yeah. For the local ones, when you aggregate in the one line, how are you weighting the zip codes or the counties?
Say that again.
You're weighting by population in the zip code or by counties?
Employment. Total employment.
And these are the changes in levels or the percentage changes?
This is the change, this is...
Normal. You like normalized everything to be the same at zero, but then...
So these are the changes over time, right? Percentage changes.
The reason I'm asking is because the initial levels of these things are going to be presumably quite different from each other, right? Like the national concentration is going to be way lower than the zip code level one. So like if you do this in percentage changes versus level changes, like you'll probably get...
Right. So this is like...
It won't change the trends, but it'll change the magnitude.
Right. So you shouldn't focus too much on the magnitude.
Okay.
I mean, the relative magnitude you can focus on, but not the levels themselves. Because we're, in some sense, taking out these fixed effects by doing everything in changes. Exactly, because we didn't want to combine industries in which the Herfindahl is normally very high relative to industries where the Herfindahl is very low. And so that combination, in some sense, that aggregation was potentially problematic. You would get a lot of composition effects. So that's a basic fact, right? And so, you know, this is kind of consistent with the introduction. Look, if we now suddenly see concentration as one of these three lines rather than the top line there, well, that paints a very different picture in terms of how these markets have evolved. So this is by sector, it's by, you know, big aggregate sector. So now I'm doing it for each individual industry and then aggregating at this sectoral level, at this one-digit sectoral level. And so, again, you see it. I mean, there's a lot of heterogeneity. Some, for some sector is larger than for others, et cetera. But pretty much you see a decline in every local measure and an increase in every national or aggregate measure. So that's very, very, very much consistent. There's the balance panel.
Oh, I cannot really do that, right?
No, OK. Bad technology for this talk, yeah. Okay, so one of the things that we want to do, and so in some sense is everywhere, right?
So at least at these average levels,
it's everywhere. Now, what I want to do now is I'm going to show you kind of a more detailed industry by industry classification, so that you see kind of where it is inside those big aggregates, right? So how does it look within those aggregates? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to run regressions essentially that tell me whether, you know, the trend is upward sloping or downward sloping for national and local concentration at the SIC 8 level, right? And then I'm gonna show you whether, you know, those numbers. And so here's some numbers for you. 61% of industries with positive have positive national trend out of those, all the industries in this SIC8 classification level, 78% of industries have local negative local zip coefficient. So if I take the definition of local, that is the zip code, right? I see declining trends in concentration, right? In 78% of employment, so industries that amount to 78% of employment in the U.S. So my example that, you know, the restaurants and so on, maybe you thought it was very particular, right? But, you know, to the extent that it applies to these industries, we're seeing these declines in local concentration, you know, seems a little bit more important. And 43% of these industries, yeah.
So Hugo's question about the over the period you're talking about, there's a very large movement toward concentration of the distribution of the U.S. population. Most zip codes have declines in population. A few zip codes, mostly coastal, have increases.
Yes.
So wouldn't that, is that an underlying explanatory factor for this finding?
It could be. I mean.
But that would be something
you can
isolate.
I agree. I mean, I think we haven't really explored the nature of these zip codes or the characteristics of the zip codes that explain, you know, where we see concentration or where there's selection of these firms. From related work, what I do know is that, you know, what's happening is these large firms are opening establishments in more and more locations. They are in all the big ones already, right? And they're going to the marginal ones that are in general smaller. Right? So Walmart is in a lot of large places, right? And then they're going to some marginal ones. On average, I mean, forget about Walmart in particular. But
on average, we see that across firms. They're expanding. Most of their expansion is in terms of more establishments,
and these establishments are happening in different locations, and these locations tend to be on average a little bit smaller.
But most zip codes have turned into wastelands. Of course, they don't have much employment, never had much employment.
Right.
It seems like
if you're a rural county and you never had employment, I mean, here you're essentially not counted here, right? So you don't matter for these calculations.
There's more uniformity of population across zip codes than there is counties. There's lots of counties that have five. There's no zip code. Well,
no, that's true.
There's two special zip codes.
No, that's true. I think that's worth studying. Okay, so this is, you know, when I open these sectors up, and so what I'm showing you here is, you know, for the different large aggregations, these are like the two-digit different sectors. So this is retail, trade, fire, and so on. And you see these graphs have different colors. Blue is industries, and I'm going to keep this coding, color coding, consistent for the rest of the talk. So remember the coding. So blue means that I see the national trend and the local trend go in the same direction, and in particular are both increasing here. Okay. So these are the sub-industry, the fraction of sub-industries in sector 53, right, where both the national and the local are increasing, is very small. That's what you're seeing here, right? It's tiny. The red are the SIC industries in that subsector where you see diverging trends. And so for 53, it's pretty much everywhere or everything, you know, and it varies depending. You see it a lot in retail, you see it in fire, you see it in services. See it less in manufacturing, but it's still there. I mean, it's still a bunch of, you still see it for a bunch of these SIC industries. You see a lot of the industries with diverging trends because a lot of these markets are very local. I mean, think about, you know, concrete, right? I mean, we know that as a like paradigmatic example of a local market, I guess, right? So
So even in manufacturing, where we see these less happening less, we see a lot of red. For some reason, there's one two-digit industry where you don't see it, which is here 21, tobacco products. So I'm not talking about tobacco products. Tobacco products are not part of this paper. These diverging trends are not there for sure.
But that's a basic fact about concentration. National concentration growing, local concentration declining, and pervasive.
The next thing is, well, you know, what explains it, or how come, what's happening?
And so, well, for that, we want to understand the role of these top firms. And so I'm going to take a sector, and I'm going to define a top firm by its 2014 sales. So the top firm at the end of the sample, right? I'm going to define that as the top firm in that industry, right? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you these trends with and without that firm, taking into account the establishments of that firm, and without when I take those establishments out of the calculation, okay? And so that's going to tell me whether this firm, this top firm, is responsible for the trends that we're seeing, okay? And so and here is the result. So the solid lines. So this is for at the zip code level. The solid lines are the ones that the lines that you already saw before, right? The dashed lines are the ones is the exercise where I'm taking out all the establishments of that top firm in a given industry, and then I'm averaging across industries in the same way that we discussed. Okay. And so what is this telling you? It's telling you, look, if I take out all the establishments of the top firm, well, national concentration doesn't grow as much. That's obvious, right? I mean, that's exactly why it's the top firm. But perhaps more surprising, if I take all the establishments of the top firm, right, what I also see is that the decline in local concentration is less pronounced, right? And so that, what that is telling you is the top firm is contributing to the decline in local concentration, is making the decline in local concentration more pronounced. Okay, so that and so it's contributing to the national increase, but it's also contribution to the local decrease. And essentially, it's the story that I was telling you is the story where these firms, you know, Walmart is expanding, and it's expanding by opening more establishments, right? And now it's competing locally with whoever was selling that at the local level, right? But it's getting a bigger and bigger national share, right?
And that essentially is what you see here, is that you see that overall. I mean, you see that on average in the U.S. economy for the sectors that have these diverging trends, right? And so this is now, of course, you can then ask, well, you know, what about, is it the top firm, or is it top two firms or three firms? I mean, we can start playing with that type of thing. And we do top three, top two in the paper. Essentially, you find the same kind of story. So
the idea that Walmart moves into a market and wipes out all the other big store retail and gets a 90% share is not right. It gets like a 30% share, and that actually reduces the, is that right?
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to show you exactly what happened when Walmart enters in a second. So, or in particular for Walmart, and I'm going to show you on average, when a top firm enters a market, what we see is that the Herfindahl, you know, there's a mechanical effect, which is when the top firm enters, the Herfindahl naturally goes down because there's one more firm, right? Unless, you know, the exit is immediate, there's one more firm. But then I'm going to show you that over time, what you see is that the Herfindahl, you know, stays down, essentially.
But Elizabeth Warren's story is that Herfindahl, because Walmart gets a 90% share and wipes out everybody else, that effect is,
that's right,
overwhelmed by.
We don't find that.
That's just not the way the world
works. We don't find that. I mean, I'm not, just to be clear, I'm not saying that when Walmart comes, there is no, you know, the locals don't suffer, right?
No.
The other sellers don't suffer in terms of, you know, having lower
shares of sales in that location. Of course they do,
right? But the point is that in most markets, what it was is that there was a local monopolist. Walmart came, and now you have two firms. And maybe, yes, that local monopolist is a lot smaller now, right? So that's what you see in a lot of these markets.
And it seems to, on average, weighted by employment to dominate
what's happening, right? So that's what this is telling us. It's telling us, look, if I do it sector by sector, for the sectors where we see diverging trends, then this is the case. Now,
Esteban,
yeah.
If I want to think of a world with a kind of oligopoly,
yes,
and I see that at the local level, somehow I must see more firms competing because, you know, whatever the market structure is, but I'm going to see a decline basically in the market power of the local level.
Yeah.
How can I get it to increase at that level? How do you want to think? Because this is just aggregation now, right? Now I'm going to aggregate all these local markets and I'm going to see that at the aggregate level, I see the opposite. How do you want me to think about this in a model of...
Well, it cannot quite be just Walmart and Target fighting it out, right? It's
firms versus establishments, right?
It's firms versus establishment. So if you have just pure oligopoly at the national level, say two firms that are entering into different places, that's what you have in mind?
I mean, I see a bunch of firms competing locally, establishments, and then all these establishments belong to a larger firm.
Yeah.
I presume that if you calculate the established, the national level concentration rate, that's at the firm level or the establishment level?
The national concentration? No, national concentration is, to the extent that the firm is operating in only one industry, is definitely, I mean, is at the firm level.
Firm level, not the establishment.
Everything is at the firm, okay, so just to be precise about this. Everything is at the firm level in the following sense. If Walmart has two stores in the same location, I'm aggregating those two stores for Walmart, right? So I'm not counting that as two stores. Which is something that you don't want to do. That would make this even stronger. Right. So then everything is at the national level. When I calculate it locally or when I calculate it nationally, it's all at the firm.
The reason why I'm asking is that there's a relationship between basically the profits or the market on the one hand and the market share.
Yeah.
And that depends on what model you have in mind.
Yes.
And I understand that this relationship is not monotone depending on the size of the market.
Yes.
Do you have an idea what can generate this? I can't think of a model that does that.
I think the model that does that is a model in which these firms are expanding by opening new locations.
Why are they expanding by opening new locations? Exactly the type of thing that Tom was talking about, namely higher fixed cost, lower variable cost, which is kind of also consistent with the type of model that you were putting in.
It's just that at the local level, all the expansion of these firms is not by growing their establishments, but by replicating establishments. Right? But the point
that you're getting at,
which I think is more of an open point, is to what extent does this constrain the market power of these firms or not? The fact that there's this decline in concentration at the local level, right? Do we think that constrains the market power of these firms, or at least these local establishments, or not? Right?
And now we cannot say that directly. Now, but we do find these big declines in concentration. So you would need to have big effects in order to really get the opposite, right? I mean, you would really need to
push in order to generate increases in market power if you see these big declines in local concentration.
Now,
one way, and this is what I think you
were referring to, let me go to that, is this,
in some sense, this can happen in two different ways, right?
One way in which this concentration can happen is
the story I've been telling, which is
Walmart comes, takes 90% of the market, and is competing locally with what used to be the local monopolist, right? And so there's declines in local concentration, increases in national, right? The other is Walmart and Target are finding it out. They're both entering into all these different locations, right? And so there's this multi-contact type of theories of competition where they are actually competing in many markets, right, at the same time. And so we, you know, and that of course can then lead to more market power because the punishing can be stronger, the incentives that you can generate from acting in many markets at the same time is stronger. We don't really see that much in the... So here is the increase in the share of markets where the top firm is. So that's the solid line. And this is the share where you also see a second or the third. So that has grown a little bit. So it's second or third, right? You see a little bit of an increase there, but that's not really the dominant story, right? So the dominant story is not Target and Walmart are all going to the same location and they're kind of competing in more and more places. Is more, you know, the top firm is expanding geographically and is in more and more places. Okay. And then the other thing is, well, is this what happens if I look at the markets or suppose I leave the top firm in the calculation, but I take out the second and the third firm, does that increase concentration and decrease local concentration or not? Do I see the same type of effects that I saw for the top firm? And the answer is clearly not. So if I take out the two, second, and third, what you see is that then actually you get more concentration, not less, more national concentration, not less. So that's all to say, it's not really about this multi-contact type of competition, right? It's not really about Target and Walmart competing in more and more places. So firm number one and firm number two, you know, are in more local markets. It's really about these firms entering these different markets and competing with local firms, firms that are there or are only in a few locations. Okay, so the final exercise that I want to show you is this one, which is exactly what when we were talking with Bob. What's the effect of when one of these top firms comes to town, right? So if they come to town, what do you see? And so this is the key graph. So this is the change or the average change in the Herfindahl index. The new establishments enters at period zero. So it's always a new establishment of a top firm. And what I'm showing you here is the Herfindahl index for including the new establishment and excluding the establishment of a top firm. So this is what I was saying before. So you get like this mechanical effect. There's more and more establishment, right? Because the firm entered. And then, you know, over time, what happens, you know, that goes up a little bit, but not a lot. It pretty much stays gone. So this is all, in industries, in the red industries, in industries with diverging trends. If I, in contrast, show you what happens in the other industries, in industries where I see both increases in national and increases in local concentration, there's not that many of those, but there's some, so I can show you what happens there, right? You see something very different. You see, you know, the top firm enters, and then what happens over time, right?
Concentration starts increasing. So that's exactly the killing,
right?
So they enter and they start, and the others start to drop or start to become really small, etc.
And so what do you find? You find that the Herfindahl, you know, after 5 years or so, the Herfindahl is about the same or larger, right? So you wiped out the effect, the mechanical effect from having one more establishment in the sector. So in this sense, the role of top firms for industries where we see these diverging trends seems very different than in industries where you don't see these diverging trends. In the industries where you see both trends increasing, firms entering actually eventually leads to more concentration.
Would you just get that by mechanically, if it's just all random, you make a selection, some institutions they offered all it up and others didn't. I mean, you almost have to get something like this, right?
Why do you say?
Well, I was saying that somehow it's perfect all went out. You select, just say if industries just some random stuff. Obviously, the Herfindahl, you selected on Herfindahl.
Oh, no. I mean,
so something has to. On average, it just be that the Herfindahl went up.
Yeah. No, you're right. So it's true that I'm selecting on the fact that, you know, there's increasing trends in both of these. So I know that on average, for sure, you know, the Herfindahl, the local concentration is growing. But I don't know that it's because of the top firm. Right? And I don't know the dynamics of it. That's what this graph is telling.
I think I read some stuff, I want to say it was Decker or Altmaier kind of stuff on business dynamism that makes not only the case for declining rate of entry, but also the case for declining rate of exit. Firms. And could that be what's going on here? That we would imagine new person comes in, lower performance exit, but you've got all these firms, some people call them zombie firms or whatever, that are just hanging on. That's why you've got this effect.
I mean, here is so that what you're seeing is that they are exiting or they are shrinking a lot.
In this one, you
could have what you're saying, which is somehow they're staying there, but they're still selling, right?
Yeah.
I mean, in the sense that they still have employment and they share, so that, you know, the Herfindahl stays more or less the same even 7 years later.
What's the time frame? The data time frame.
So 1990 to 2014 is the whole data, and this is depends on, you know, the date of the entry. So the final thing is Walmart. So I can do these same graphs for Walmart in particular. So for the industry, so the industry where Walmart mostly operates is one of these red industries, and in fact, when I show you what's happening in exactly that industry where Walmart is the top firm. You see exactly the same picture, right? So that's just like one particular example of that. Now, when I look at one particular sector, in this case, the one where Walmart is the top firm, I can also show you the number of establishments in the zip code. What happens to the number? So we've been talking about is there exit or not, etc. Now, showing you exit in general is tricky because again, there's lots of competition effects. But in one particular sector, you can do that. And so here's what's happening. So there's Walmart enters, right? And so what happens when Walmart enters? Well, you get about 2/3 of an extra establishment. So Walmart enters, about 1/3 of an establishment exits. It's on average, right, across markets. But you get an increase in the number of establishments of about 2/3. And so that's essentially what's generating the effect on the Herfindahl that I was showing you.
Isn't that the point said earlier that, you know, if Walmart goes to growing in zip code, doesn't that give you this automatically? So its entry decision is, I go to a place that's growing.
Yes.
And therefore the market grows, and therefore also other firms do that, so you get on average more. The fact that they enter, is a sign that it's a growing zip code.
Well, but I mean, that's not true here, right, for this industry.
Well, this is a select example.
No, there's a bunch of industries in which that's not happening, and there's some industries in which it is happening. The industries where it's happening tend to be the more local industries, right? Now, it is a selected, I mean, I'm selecting blue and green, depending on those aggregate trends, that's true. Did I answer? Maybe I didn't answer, but we can try more again. Okay, so you know, Walmart essentially looks the same. It is, I mean, I don't know, this thing about increases in certain zip codes, etc., in terms of population, I think concentration doesn't change automatically. I mean, this particular measure of concentration has some level effects. But there's lots of measures of concentration that don't have level effects, right? So just the fact that you have more people there doesn't mean that concentration is going to move in a particular way. OK.
So
the conclusion should be clear by now, I hope. We've looked at these measures of concentration. There's a literature out there that has emphasized the fact that national concentration has grown. Lots of markets are local. And when you look at local concentration, you see a very different picture. You see a decline in all the aggregates, national aggregates for all the main industries. 3/4 of the employment in the US economy is in sectors where you see declines in local concentration. And essentially, this is happening because these large firms, the top firms in a market, are expanding geographically. And so the way they are expanding, right? So what's going on? The way these firms are expanding, in some sense, is constraining them, right? If you, the way you expand, if you're a restaurant chain, if the way you expand is by having to compete locally with the local restaurants, well, that limits how you can behave, even if you're getting a big chunk of the national market. The fact that that expansion is a geographic expansion limits its effects and limits, in some sense, the potentially the implications for market power of that expansion. And this is, in some sense, what we're saying is nothing very revealing. I mean, this is something that people in the antitrust community have been saying. Look, calm down. Don't use these aggregate measures to think about antitrust policy. We want something that is a lot finer than that. And so Carl Shapiro, for example, has been hypothesizing that exactly you would find the type of patterns in local concentration that we find. But you know, we didn't have the data before, or people had not calculated this before, and we have.
Okay, thank you.